Good morning to everyone. On the behalf of the Department of Mathematics, KPR Institute of Engineering and Technology, Coimbatore, I welcome you all for the 6-day faculty development program on applications of mathematics in engineering. Today is the 5th day. It is indeed a great privilege bestowed on me to extend a pleasant good morning to one and all who have gathered here online through interactive platform media and be enthusiastic participants in the 6-day webinar on applications of mathematics in engineering. First of all, on behalf of the KPR IIT management, Principal Dr. M. Magila, Chief Executive Dr. A. M. Nadarajan, and on my own behalf, I feel grateful and fortunate in welcoming the resource person, Dr. Hari Ponnamarani, Associate Professor of Mathematics, NIT Warangal, to this August online gathering. I welcome you, Dr. Hari Ponnamarani. I am delighted in welcoming all the participants who have gathered here online from various parts of the globe. For the next 60 minutes or so, Dr. Hari Ponnamarani will be elaborating on the topics applications of finite volume method in engineering, making an earnest attempt to reach out the quench the intellectual needs of the participants. Now I request our head of the department, Professor K.S. Ramaswamy, to introduce the resource person.
Good morning, everyone gathered here online. Dr. H.P. Rani is currently working as an Associate Professor of Mathematics, National Institute of Technology, Warangal, Telangana. She has more than 20 years of experience at the abroad and India put together and more than 43 publications in reputed, referred national and international journals. She has supervised 2 PhDs. Her areas of interest include nonlinear dynamics, finite difference methods, finite volume methods, computational fluid dynamics, instability and vortex analysis, heat and mass transfer problems. And she has won projects, Authority of Department of Atomic Energy, Mumbai, project names CFD analysis of FAC problems in pipes and pipe bends, project cost rupees 28 lakhs, duration 3 years, sanction date 2009. It is our fortunate to have such an eminent personality with us. Now I hand over the session to Dr. Rani Madam and request her to start the session. Madam, please go ahead, Madam. Madam, not audible, Madam.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Good morning to all of you. I thank KPR Institute for asking me to present my finite volume methods along with its application. Whatever I have done in my research work, I thought of sharing with you all so that you will also have a glimpse of understanding how we can apply our mathematical methods. Finite volume methods, finite difference and finite element methods are coming under the category of advanced numerical methods. More specifically, we call them as computational methods. I will start this one with the outline. Why we have to do this one? Actually, any entity can be modeled as real world model. In the observation, if you go, can you see here? Sir, can you answer me? My screen is visible?
Yes, madam.
Yeah. So, if you go to the oceanic circulations or wind circulations, the observations you can see here, this is the velocity profile and this is the temperature profile. So, this is published in Nature Communication, one of the highest journals. And they modeled this one, or they observed this. From the data, they have drawn this velocity curves and the temperature isotherms. Okay, if we, in the experiments, what they did is, to analyze these things, they have set up the very first heat transfer models are given by Rayleigh-Bernard cells. You can see here very well that the experimental setup. Here is a camera to capture the velocities and temperature contours also. And here, such a big setup they have to do to capture the streamlines or isotherms, whatever we call, to capture the flow variables, especially the dependent variables, how they are moving with respect to time also, they are capturing and they are recording in the computer. Okay. Same thing in analytical method, this observation and experiments have been reproduced by our Subramaniam Chandrasekhar, okay, the astrophysicist who defined how stars behave by Subramaniam Chandrasekhar. This is I have got from Science Springs. You can see Chandrasekhar sir here, and he has written this one, hydrodynamic and hydromagnetic stability, and he defined a Chandrasekhar number based on Lorentz force to viscous force. So this analytical method is so powerful that he gave or he reproduced the experimental and observational results also. Now coming to computational fluid dynamics, you can see here the we are starting this one, and geometry modeling, whatever geometry we want to simulate, this is a geometry. Here is the bottom wall is the hot wall and top wall is the cold wall, and we want to simulate the flow here. So this is a geometry, and we have to define the initial and boundary conditions for this one, and then we mesh it, then we use the solver to solve the governing equations. So what is analytical thing we have observing here is geometry modeling we are taking from the observations, and we are writing the governing equations, which are non-linear equations, non-linear partial differential equations along with the boundary conditions. Along with the boundary conditions, one second. Along with the boundary conditions, then we apply the meshing. Here only the mathematics plays a crucial role. In the meshing, we use graph theory knowledge, and in the solver, I am going to use this computational techniques called finite difference method, finite element, finite volume method. Here I have used the finite volume method to get the flows like velocity flow. Here these are nothing but the velocity vectors. Along the velocity vectors we have drawn the streamlines. You can see the streamlines, how perfectly it is showing, which cannot be observed through experiments. Even through observations also, you cannot accurately at a specific time get such type of results. Our Chandrasekhar said that such type of rectangular structures are available if you apply the magnetic field also, along the temperature field. So with this parameters, you can see here, Chandrasekhar number is 2000 and the heating parameter is 30,139. Exactly this is specified by Chandrasekhar, and I can able to get such type of structures here. So this is done in post-processing, and we have to do the grid independence test whether our results are correct or not. So nowadays, computational fluid dynamics is becoming very powerful, such that it can able to reproduce all the experimental observational results, etc. Okay, so this is a total model I can able to tell you that, so that you can understand the things. Okay, now coming to our system of equations, computational method, system of non-linear partial differential equations using finite volume method. So what's so, why finite volume method is so powerful? You can see the graph here. This is the annual revenue of commercial CFD softwares over the years, plotted from 2001 to 2015. So nowadays, almost all the commercial softwares have been switched over to finite volume method. In the coming slides, I will tell that what is the specialty of finite volume method, why everyone has been switched over here. They are touching around 1,000 million dollars per year for their total revenue. Apart from that, they are gaining software licenses, maintenance and service, and their net income also keeps on increasing year by year. So we can understand our methods and try to apply for the real-time applications. So the standard form of transport equation for any scalar property phi is given by the general equation which is we are using for solving any type of equation. So this is a partial derivative with respect to time. Here small t denotes the time derivative and rho is a constant. If it is a constant, as usually we take it out. Otherwise, if it is a function of time derivative, we kept it inside. And this is a scalar property phi. Here phi is known as the dependent variable for which we want to solve this equation. Next, here divergence of these three things. Now here, if three independent variables are there, if rho is a constant, we take it out and v is the velocity. If this is also there, then this is the non-linear term which gives all type of oscillations, disturbance while solving this equation. Coming to the right-hand side here, we have if gamma is the diffusion coefficient and it is also constant, we can take it out and this is divergence of del becomes del square phi plus the source term. So this is the basic equation. Now we are going to change this phi to different type of variables. For example, in the previous case, I have shown about the heating of the plate. Then this phi takes for the variable temperature we call. If we add the concentration also, we want to find out then how much the mixture gets the concentration. Then phi will be replaced with concentration variable. If we want to solve for velocity flow only, then this phi will be replaced with velocity. So like this. If I put phi equal to 1, this phi is constant, then you can simply derive this equation called as mass conservation equation or continuity equation. See, dou rho by dou t plus del dot rho v bar, because phi is 1, which is equals to 0 if there exists no source term. Coming to the second equation, this is a very powerful called as Navier-Stokes equation, otherwise momentum equation. Here phi is nothing but v bar only. Phi is the velocity vector itself. Then here velocity and again instead of phi we have velocity, and this side one more source term comes into picture, which is nothing but pressure gradient, negative pressure gradient, and here gamma is replaced with mu del v bar plus this source term. Coming to the energy equation, here phi is replaced with temperature, the same equation only. And lastly, this is known as species concentration equation, where phi is replaced with c. So now in the next slides, what I'm going to show you is how to get the solution of this basic equation. That's it. Once we understand how to solve this equation, then we can able to produce all these results. All these results means how to calculate the dependent variable value. Okay, now let us go some more deep into what is finite volume method. The standard form of transport equation for a scalar property phi is, again I am writing the equation with the names of this one. Okay. The first term in the left hand side is known as the convective term. I have taken the right hand side term to the left hand side. This is known as diffusion term and this is the source term. Here I have removed the time derivative. We can include the time derivative and we can solve this one. This term is known as convective term, nonlinear term, otherwise acceleration term also. Now, this is a simple control volume where we are going to solve the our governing equation. Governing equation means which I have shown before. This I call it as governing equation. So, in the control volume, wherever we want to find out the value, we are fixing that in the middle of the control volume and the neighboring nodes, we call it as W and E. This is known as west side. This is known as east side. This is one dimensional case. If we go for the two dimensional case, then I have the above one is north one, the below one is south. And if I go for the three dimensional case, top and bottom also come into picture. So this is a typical control volume which we are considering, and we are going to integrate the above governing equation over this control volume CV. Okay. So now here the same thing only I have written, but here I am including capital W and capital E also, which are known as nodal points. We are going to calculate only the value of the dependent variable at these nodal points, not at the phases. Okay, it should be remembered that. But the phases of the control volume only we are going to integrate over this. same thing only I have represented in the two dimensional case. So P is situated in the middle of the control volume with the east face, west face, north face, south face. And here is the top and bottom boundaries also comes into picture. And you can see here delta x and delta y. Delta x is the spacing between two faces and delta two x direction faces. Delta y is the distance between two y direction faces. What is the methodology and advantages we are going to see here? Methodology, FEM uses integral form of conservation transport equation. So all the transport equation is whichever I have shown before. So we are going to see the integral form of that one. That is integrating over the control volume. So the domain is subdivided into control volumes like this. Surface and volume integrals are approximated by numerical quadrature. So the integration is done with the help of numerical quadrature like trapezoidal rule, Simpson rule. Okay. Next, after writing those rules, then we have to do the interpolation to find out the values at the capital W, capital P and capital E. So that we are using the interpolation techniques. Interpolation is used to express the variable values at control volume phases in terms of nodal values. It results an algebraic equation per control volume, and this algebraic equation is used in the matrix form. We are going to get that one. Nowadays we are using algebraic multigrid method and CGS method to solve such type of algebraic equation. Basically we know Thomas algorithm to solve a tridiagonal matrix. So this is the methodology for finite volume method. So what is the advantage of finite volume method is it is suitable for any type of grid. Here I am showing the equal spacing between capital W, capital P, similarly for P and E. So if I say this is distance is delta x, here also I am fixing the distance as delta x. Even if it is delta x1, delta x2 also, we can able to integrate it is over the control volume and we can apply the finite volume method. That is the main advantage of finite volume method, and also it removes the oscillations which are coming in the solutions. How it is removing the oscillations, that also we are going to see that one. That is the second advantage. Next, because of this conservation, the mass is conserved within this control volume. So there are three main advantages of using finite volume method in comparison with finite difference and finite element methods. Okay, so almost all the commercial softwares nowadays, CFX, Fluent, CFDRC, Cosmol, Star CD, Flow 3D, even the open source softwares like OpenFOAM, etc. have been switched over to finite volume methods. Okay, now let us take term by term and we are going to integrate that one over the control volume. First, let us take the diffusion term which occurs in the right-hand side of the transport equation. So, we are integrating over the control volume. This I have shown in the red color. That is, we are integrating from W to E. Isn't it? W to here, W to E, we are integrating this one, and applying the Gauss divergence theorem, I can convert volume integral to the surface integral, and then applying the Simpson's rule or trapezoidal rule, I can able to write down this integration like this, summation of the points, and here this one, del phi is written as dou phi by dou n over the phase E, this phase E. Now, how to evaluate this value? So this can be evaluated with respect of the neighboring nodes. So dou phi by dou e is nothing but phi at this point capital E minus the previous point divided by the distance between these two points. I think it, hope it is clear. Like this, we are going to do for each and every point, discretized point. Similarly, let's do for the source term which is occurring on the right hand side. Again, integrating over the control volume. So this source term is multiplied by the volume plus again one more term. We are going to rearrange this one such that this value should be less than zero. In this way, we are linearizing the source term also. Okay, the main disturbance comes from the convective term. This occurs in the left hand side. Again, integrating over the control volume and applying the Gauss divergence theorem, we can able to write this one. And using this trapezoidal rule or Simpson's rule, we are rewriting this one in the summation form over all nodal points. Then again, we are combining this one and mass flux, this is known as density and the unknown variable along with the velocity. We are writing this one as the mass flux of this over each phase. So that's what it is written, where subscript E denotes one of the phases of the cell. Cell means here control volume. A is the area of the phase E. V suffix EN is a velocity component in the direction that is normal to the phase. Thus, CE denotes the mass flux. Okay. There are different methods to solve this convective term, namely upwind method, quick super B and SFCD numerical methods are available in finite volume. We are going to see that how they behave for this solution of the convective term. And graphically, I am going to show you that among these methods, which method gives the better solution. Okay. Before proceeding further, let us understand these schemes. First one is known as upwind differencing scheme. This is the usual control volume only. Here we have to think about the flow direction. If the flow direction is in the, that is velocity is greater than zero, means we assume that flow is in the positive direction. If velocity is negative, means the flow is in the negative direction. That is moving from the nodal point capital E to capital W. Okay. So the value of phi, the dependent variable at an interface, is equal to the value of phi at the grid point on the upwind side of the phase. Upwind means if the flow is in the positive direction, means this is upwind, this is downside and this is the upper side. So upwind side of the phase. Okay. So that's what the flow is in the positive direction means. This variable phi at this point is nothing but replaced with phi at capital P, because we know the values only at the nodal points. If the flow is in the negative direction, that is why I put here less than zero, then this phi is replaced with the before point, because flow is coming from right to left. Therefore, this value is replaced with this one. And this scheme is known as first order differencing scheme. It never gives any oscillations at the solution, but it is very slow for complicated geometries. Till now, we are using upwind differencing scheme only. In short, we call it as UDS scheme. The value of phi w can be defined similarly. This value, how to get this value, also depends on the flow direction. Okay, the second scheme is known as central differencing scheme. The name itself tells that we are going to choose the value of E with the help of the two neighboring nodes. So central of this one. So you can see here, I am using capital E also, capital P also. Okay, so phi E, the same phi E only, is approximated with the help of capital E and capital P with some relaxation parameter we can call lambda. Lambda is calculated with the help of distance between these points. And if lambda becomes 1, so what will happen? This will go back to the upwind differencing scheme. See, for example, if lambda equals 1, this term goes off, capital phi E is nothing but capital phi E. So you are going here. If lambda equal to 0, then this term goes off, this will become this one. Okay. When oscillatory behavior happens, this central differencing scheme, being the simplest second order and it's one of the most widely used differencing scheme, it gives somewhat, because it is of second order, it gives somewhat better results in comparison with upwind differencing scheme. But it is oscillatory in nature, that we have to remember, and we are going to take a numerical example and we will see that one. Next scheme is known as self-filtered centered interpolation scheme, nothing but SFCD scheme. What it is doing, it is utilizing both upwind differencing scheme and central differencing scheme. See, in the upwind differencing scheme, there is no oscillations. That is why it is bounded scheme. And central differencing scheme is more accurate. That is why it is utilizing accuracy of central differencing scheme. So central differencing scheme is used with unphysical extrema is removed with the help of a filter we are going to introduce. In the previous case, we have introduced the filter lambda. Now we are going to introduce that one. I'll show that one. You can see here the SFCB scheme is using central differencing scheme and the upper difference scheme with the help of the filter called gamma. If gamma equals to 1, then we are using only the central differencing scheme. If gamma equals to 0, then we are using only the UDS scheme. If it is between 0 to 1, we are using the average of these two schemes. That is what written here. Okay. And it is given by Swaby in the year 1984. Okay. The next scheme is quick scheme, quadratic upstream interpolation for convective kinetics. The name itself tells that it is nothing but the quadratic scheme. We are going to make use of the one more neighboring node. In the previous case, we have used only two nodes. Now we are going to make use of three nodes here. That is, if I call capital PSI, W is known as I minus 1 and capital E is I plus 1. You can see here I minus 1, I minus 2 also it is using. That is the previous one. This is I minus 1, I minus 2. So that's what here it is written. W, P and WW also. Otherwise P, E and W also. This phase values are replaced with these formulas based on the flow direction for the quadratic upwind scheme. And here the disadvantage is boundedness fails, that is it gives the oscillations in the solution. And it is given by Leonard in the year 1779. The next scheme is total variation diminishing scheme, which is nothing but some of the first order UDS scheme and higher order correction is implemented here. What is that higher order scheme? You can see here, this is UDS scheme and the higher order correction scheme is employed here. How to get that one? From the distance between the neighboring nodes, we are calculating this TVD scheme value psi. So therefore, psi is function of R. And it is given by Hartel in the year 1983 and consecutive year 84 also. The next one is Super B method, which is the extension of TVD method, the previous scheme, which chooses any one of these values, whichever is maximum. Okay, now let us go back to one numerical example and solve this equation with the help of the previous schemes, whichever I have explained. Okay, for finite volume methods and simple examples, we can refer this book, An Introduction to Computational Fluid Dynamics, the Finite Volume Method by Versteg and Malalasekram. Okay, let us consider a simple equation, a simple ordinary differential equation where the flow is assumed to be in the positive direction. With the boundary conditions, this value is 1 and this dependent variable is 0 at the right hand side, that is when x equals to 1. This is defined like this and the analytical solution of this equation is given for this. Now, if we apply the previous schemes, you can see here the analytical solution is given in green color and central differencing scheme, which gives oscillations with respect to the five nodes. Five nodes means here I am splitting the given region from x equal to 0 to x equal to 1 in terms of five nodal points. So 1 divided by 5. So if I apply the upwind differencing scheme, which is denoted in this gray color, it is the bounded scheme. That is why it is not showing any oscillations here and not deviating too much from the analytical solution also. The quick scheme, as usually it is giving higher order scheme, that is why it is giving the oscillations. And Super B scheme and SFCD scheme are not giving any oscillations and it is also moving along with the analytical solution. Okay, if I increase the number of nodes, 5 to 20 nodes, then you can see here, all are giving the solution which is near to the analytical solution. So what we can observe from this figure is, the Super B and SFCD schemes show the bounded solutions without oscillations with less number of nodes. Even with the 5 nodes also, we are not getting any oscillations with respect to Super B and SFCD schemes. So can you hear me? Just I want to check, and if you have any doubts, please let me know. Hello?
Then you can proceed, ma'am. It's clearly visible.
Okay. So in this way, we discretize all the equations and we are rewriting the given equations in the algebraic form, that is in the matrix form. Here is the unknown variable at the unknown points, and here are the neighboring points. That is what denoted as NV here. So we are putting the neighboring points, known values on the right hand side, and unknown variables, the dependent variable, in the left hand side. Then we will get the matrix form. When the governing PDE is formulated for each computational cell, it results in a set of coupled linear algebraic equations. An iterative procedure is employed at every time step, namely algebraic multigrid method. Okay. So now this is the methods which I want to stress in the finite volume method, and how the solution behaves also I have showed here. Now let us take one theoretical work which also deals with such type of problems. So now whatever I have shown is computational method. Okay, how it collaborates evidences the theoretical work also, and very nicely it shows the results. This work, Rayleigh-Bernard convection, the first problem experimentally, I have experimental or observation, and analytically, this problem has been very well recorded. That is known as Rayleigh-Bernard convection. Ma and Wang has done dynamics and structures in the physical space. How the structures of this convection takes place, that they have showed in the paper, which is published in 2007. Here. Okay, yeah, it is written here. You can see 2007 it is published. The main objective of this article is a part of research program to link the dynamics of fluids with the structure of these flows in physical space and the transition of their structures. So when the flow evolves, when the velocity, the dependent variable, keeps on changing, how the flow is getting transitional phase. That's what they want to show, that one. To demonstrate these main ideas, we study the two-dimensional Rayleigh-Bernard convection, which serves as a prototype problem. The analysis is based on two recently developed nonlinear theories, geometric theory for incompressible flows and bifurcation and stability theory for nonlinear dynamical systems. So my interest also goes here only. That is why I am currently working in nonlinear dynamical systems with the help of the real world problems like Rayleigh-Bernard convection problems. Okay, so these are the governing equations which he has taken and defined in a two-dimensional domain. R1 cross the height of this cell he has taken as, or this cavity he has taken as H, with the H is greater than 0. Okay, so the divergence of U, that is what the mass conservation equation, which is the first equation I have showed you, and this is nothing but the temperature equation, and this is the momentum equation. Here you can compare this one with the transport equation, which I have showed in my equations in the second slide. Okay, now he is analyzing these equations and with the help of these boundary conditions, Dirichlet boundary conditions. In experimentally, they are known as rigid boundary conditions, and the other one is free boundary conditions, where this derivative boundary conditions comes into picture, and we call it as Neumann boundary conditions. Next one is combination of these two. The Dirichlet is for rigid, and this free for Neumann boundary conditions. You can see here, and the initial value with for the time is given like this. Okay. So when he, after his analyzation, he made a conclusion that the velocity variable will look like this if we plot the structures here. So that it is moving like a cell. This is the different cells he has showed with respect to the direction also. So the hot wall is here and the cold wall is here, and the flow is taking place like this. For example, if you take this cell, it is moving in this direction. Okay. Similarly, if I able to do the same problem in the computational fluid dynamics, that is using the finite volume method, I can also able to reproduce such type of cells for the Rayleigh number 658. And if I multiply this one with 2, then I'm getting such type of structures. So whatever Ma and Wang in their theoretical results showed this one, it is coinciding very well with the computational fluid dynamics results also. Okay, further, the isotherms also I have showed here. For the same Rayleigh number 658, you can see this, how this temperature lines are here. So initially they are not moving because the conduction state occurs later. If I increase this value, that is if the temperature, you can see here bottom wall is of the hot temperature and the top wall is of the cold temperature. That is why this color is here red and here it is blue in color. If you keep on increasing the temperature, thin boundary layer starts to show its presence, and from the top, the slowly the cold fluid, because of density variations, it is coming down. If I further increase the temperature, then slowly the convection starts to move. That is, the velocity starts to move over this fluid. And here I have considered the fluid as liquid gallium. With respect to liquid gallium, I have given the properties for density, etc. Okay, so this is experimentally observed results also, and this is given in some of the papers, like for the rigid boundary conditions, Arnau and Wolson has given this results. Okay, coming to the field synergy. Synergy means coordination. Coordination between the velocity vector and the temperature gradient is shown here. Here you can see that here every picture, these two pictures very clearly shows when the temperature increases in the middle, the coordination between the temperature and the velocity vector is well. But coming to the side walls, the coordination is not good. So we have to ensure that at which Rayleigh number we have to go for the industrial problems. For such type of industrial analysis, these field synergy plays a crucial role. Okay, some of the applications whichever I have carried out using the finite volume method, I want to show here because the title also goes for real-time applications. Okay. So the first one, fundamental study I have done, backward facing step, how the flow takes place in a step channel and within the cavity also. Here heating is taking place. Here without heating, simply I have taken the dependent variable as velocity vector, and I have shown the papers which are published in JFM and Physics of Fluids. Coming to the next one, biology, microcirculation in liver. What is happening inside the liver? How the blood moves inside the liver. Like that, I have done 2-3 problems which I will explore now. And the flow assisted corrosion, this is what just now in the introduction he said, this is a BRNS project from Department of Atomic Energy, and this has published in Engineering Failure, Nuclear Engineering Design and Annals of Nuclear Energy. These are the problems which I want to show you. And this is a Chandrasekhar problem which I have showed you in the first slide, which has applications in geophysical fluid dynamics. Okay, coming to the first problem, microcirculation in liver. So I have tried to simulate the liver flow here because it has two inputs. The arrow mark shows here and one output here. Inside the blue color, these regions are output regions. When I sent this paper to Journal of Biomechanics, the reviewer comments said that hemodynamics of hepatic microcirculation, the liver cells are known as hepatic cells, that is why it is known as hepatic microcirculation, is still a dark, unclear field for us, but it is really very important for TACE for hepatic tumor. TACE means transarterial chemoembolization. Whatever surgery, chemo means, I think all of you know that it is nothing but the cancer therapy. So they are doing the cancer therapy for the liver cells. So for that one, they are calling it as transarterial chemoembolization. Through the artery, they are injecting the medicine and they are analyzing this one. And they have appreciated, I appreciate your great work very much. And I hope your study can bring a breakthrough in the hepatic tumor studies. That is what they have mentioned. So now this is the simulation here. Here this is the pressure driven flow. Due to the pressure, the fluid is getting moved inside. So these are nothing but the velocity vectors only. So the velocity vectors are shown in terms of the pressure color. So the pressure is shown in terms of newtons per meter square. You can see here the hepatic arteriole, which comes from the our heart pump blade. Because of that, it has very high pressure and pumps out the blood and moves through the flow directions shown here, and these are known as fenestrations. Through the fenestrations, the blood is coming out, and different types of actions are taking place in this region especially. Still, it is unclear field in the biology how they are getting function. So, as a mathematician, we have an important role to analyze the flow behavior in these regions such that the more medical engineering side, they can understand the behaviors in these regions. And this is known as hepatic venule, where the flow totally gets drained out. And here, this is nothing but the stress. How much stress is happening for the geometry? Here you can see that because of too much pressure, the hepatic arteriole is undergoing the stress, which we used to calculate using the wall shear stress. The next problem, flow in the backward facing step channel. You can see the step over here. The flow is coming from the inlet, moving upwards and falling down here. When it falls down, it creates the vortices. How I can able to locate the vortices is, we know that vortex is nothing but del cross V bar. Using that formula, once we know the velocity value from the governing equations, which we have solved using the finite volume method, then apply del cross V, and you can see the values which are located in near to the walls. In the near the both walls, we have the eddies. Apart from that, here also there is a shear layer eddy. It is shown very clearly here. The shear layer eddy is shown along with the sidewall eddies. So here also the nonlinear equations showed more than one results. Initially, when the parameter is up to 738, we have got only one solution. When the parameter is increased, it becomes two solutions, and further increase means it will give number of solutions, which is known as chaotic solutions. I have gone up to Reynolds number 2000, for which I got two different solutions, which is justified with respect to the governing equations. How to substantiate my results? When I solved each problem, I have to compare those results either with observations, experiments, or analytical work. Here, I have compared these results with the experiments which are done by Armory et al. I have shown that reference here, who has done the reverse flow regions in the three-dimensional backward facing step flow. These rectangles are my results, and this line is nothing but Williams and Baker results, and the circles are Williams and Baker results. Armley et al. Is shown in diamonds with the line. So our computational results are very well coinciding with the experimental results. In that way, we are justifying whatever we are showing is correct. Okay, the next one is a heating problem. The side walls are getting heated. Here I have to take up the temperature equation also, the energy conservation equation also, which I have shown the third equation in my slide. Here also the nonlinearity of the governing equation is justified. You can see here, initially we are getting a single solution. Later we are getting two different solutions, and one solution is behaving steadily without any disturbance or stable solution. The other solution is showing me the unstable solutions. And if we keep on increasing using the dynamical systems knowledge, we can classify the solutions as periodic solutions, frequency doubling solutions. Later, they are becoming the more number of solutions which cannot be predicted with respect to the time. That is known as chaotic solutions or turbulent solutions. Okay. Coming to the geophysical and astrophysical applications, rotating Rayleigh-Bernard convection with vertical magnetic field is analyzed here. Okay. So the governing equations, again, mass conservation equation. This is a magnetic equation. And here, because of this temperature differences only, the density differences comes into play, and it interacts with the gravitational force, and velocity convection starts to occur. So this equation is nothing but our momentum equation along with the magnetic force terms. Because of the rotation, this term comes into picture. These two terms induces the Coriolis fields, which I have shown here. Coriolis force, centrifugal force, and this is nothing but the Lorentz force and Beyonce force. See here, G is shown here, the gravitational force. And this is our diffusion term, and this is the pressure gradient term. And now I have solved in the previous cases, whichever I have showed, I solved only for the diffusion term and the advection term using the upwind differencing scheme, SFCD scheme, etc. Now here I have added more number of source terms and solving these equations along with, this is known as magnetic equation, and this is our temperature equation. So already I have showed you this rectangular structures, and I have told you also Arnau and Woltzen have generated such type flow, and I have compared my results again to substantiate, to validate my results. I compared these results with them, which have done experimental work, and this is showing very well the coincidence of the results. This is a project for flow accelerated corrosion, and this is the geometry which we have to do. Actually, the metal is here, the fluid is flowing inside the metal, and it is getting the metal is getting corroded because of the fluid. So that is what is the mechanism is happening. I have shown here the concentration equation comes into play here. The concentration gets dissolved, that is the ferrous ions the ferrous ions becoming ferrous oxide because of presence of the water, and it is moving along with the bulk fluid, that is known as CB. Okay. So this is because of very high velocity flow is occurring, we have to go for turbulence flow. Turbulence flow is governed by Reynolds average Navier-Stokes equation. Here we have to consider the mean velocity, and the mean velocity is injected in the our momentum equation. You can compare this equation with the momentum equation which I have shown here. Use velocity vector along with this, the mean value of the velocity should be considered. And what is our aim? This extra term, how to find out this one? That is given from the Bosnich theorem, which is says that this quantity is proportional to the average velocity gradient, and it can be calculated with this eddy viscosity. This is known as eddy viscosity, and this is known as gradient terms. With the help of those equations, after solving them using the finite volume method, we have compared our feeder bend pipes, which we got from the Department of Atomic Energy, and this CFD results. You can see here they have located some corrosion points, and these are coinciding very well with this one. Hence, our results are validated with this one. Here, what is the mechanism we have used? We have used the wall shear stress to calculate these values. How to calculate the wall shear stress? It is calculated with the help of velocity gradients. Okay. Further, we have compared our results with Canadian nuclear power plant data, and that also showed good results. Okay. So these are some of the real-time applications which I have applied with the help of finite volume method. So I want to conclude this session. So with the quote from Mother Teresa, I alone cannot change the world, but I can cast a stone across the waters to create many ripples. So if you have any questions, please let me know.
Yes, ma'am, it is a very nice presentation. Ma'am, I am also working in the finite volume method, so I have two doubts, ma'am. You have explained various schemes, upwind, quick scheme, and TVDS. But what about the power law scheme? This is also a preferable one, right?
Power law scheme is a different one, na? Newtonian fluid, non-Newtonian fluids. That's what you are telling.
Yeah, yes, ma'am. Yeah, yes, ma'am.
That is how to define a fluid. Nothing to do with finite volume method. Okay, one second. Can you see my screen?
Yeah, yes, ma'am.
For my this microcirculatory liver flow, I have shown. There I have used power law scheme.
Yeah,
here you can see this. The power law model is represented like this. Okay, where this viscosity also exists in terms of other variables. Only in the viscosity, this power law comes into picture, not in the solution of the governing equations, how to solve them. Finite volume method is a method to solve the equations, that's it. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. And then we have properties of the schemes. That is the conservativeness, boundedness, and transferableness. We have three properties.
Yes.
And then which scheme satisfies all these properties, ma'am?
And the simple differencing scheme satisfies the boundedness, transportiveness, everything, but it is first order accurate scheme.
Yes,
what is the thing is, if we go for such type of complex geometries, whichever I have shown, this complex geometries, it is in 10 to the power of minus 6. This is denoted in micrometers, not even in millimeters, this geometry. So such type of fine structures, we should have very fine calculations. If you go for second order accuracy, for example, central differencing scheme, higher order schemes and all, we are getting too much of oscillations. Sometimes the solution shows negative results, positive results, etc. So I have used only the first order scheme here. If you go for a structured geometry like a cubical cavity, etc., I have gone for the higher order schemes. So it depends on problem, which one you have to use. Okay. So you see the problem, then go for the judgment about the scheme.
Ma'am, in your cavity problem, the empty cavity, but inside the cavity there is no obstruction. Because if we have obstruction, then what will be the velocity? How to implement the velocity conditions?
Yeah, velocity also you are defining the boundary conditions clearly, na? For example, backward facing step flow I showed. That step is an obstacle. Yeah. Okay. So the geometry, the equations are defined inside the domain, and the boundary only defines your domain. So where you have to give which type of boundary, that is from 0 to L by 2, L by 2 to another one, L. So you are splitting your boundary in such a way that the half part is here, the other half is here, and both have different conditions.
Okay. Thank you.
Dr. Ramin, madam, please accept our sincere congratulations and thank you very much for your excellent presentation, madam.
Yeah.
It was interesting, informative, notable, striking, remarkable, and fabulous, madam. Everyone has observed the clarity in presentation and the clarity in discussions. I am very sure that the participants would have relished and enhanced their knowledge in the domain of applications of finite volume methods in engineering. I have been seeing